Good afternoon. So thanks for joining my session. I will try to explain you how to understand how the Nova community works and about our processes. So in case you want to start to work with Nova, it will be loving, and I will explain you also how to discuss with us. So first, let me explain me who am I. So I'm Sylvain Boza. I'm a principal software engineer from Red Hat. I'm working on OpenStack since 10 years. And I'm also the Nova PTL. First, for today, I will explain you about some misunderstanding that I was understanding, that I was listening when I was discussing with some folks. Sometimes some folks tell me, for example, well, I don't have time. So I will reply and explain why it's not a problem. This is not a problem, first, because not all the contributors from the Nova team are actually having most of their all time, for example, for a week, for Nova. As you can see, for the Nova community, for example, we have three types of contributors. For example, we have some on-off contributors that are only here, for example, for some bug report or for some specific feature. We also have some domain experts that don't really know about the world Nova and code, but at least they know about something specific. But we also have, I would say, white knights. Those are just here because they just want to help Nova. That's basically it. And they are here, maybe not for the whole week, but just because they have time to for us. If you look at the community, for example, if you look at all the Caracal commits we had, in general, when I'm discussing with some folks, they'll tell me, for example, for Nova, most of the contributors are from Red Hat. This is wrong. This is wrong, because if you look, for example, at the numbers, you will see that most of the contributors are not from Red Hat, from Caracal. That means that even if most of the Nova cores, most of the Nova maintainers are from the Red Hat company, we also look, of course, about other changes. That's not that you need to be on some specific company for working on Nova. No. Look at that. You can be from any company. Also, when I'm discussing with folks, when they tell me I don't have time, they also tell me, like, for example, I tried to work on Nova, but it took me too much time. Here, I'm trying to explain, that for the release development cadence, maybe you don't know, but every 6 months we have a new release. For those 6 months, we only not merge some changes only by 3 weeks. That's basically it. That said, from the previous release candidate one, if you have questions, I will be helping you the agenda, for example, for Dalmatian, for that specific release. But for example, we have a day which is called release candidate one. When we create a release candidate one, when we create an RC one, we basically branch the previous release to a specific stable branch, and then master starts to be the new release. Even if the previous, for example, at the moment, as I speak, for example, Dalmatian is close to pre-release candidate 1, but once we branch Dalmatian RC1, then you could be starting to work on the next release. And that's not a problem. So basically, people can start to work on a specific release by the previous release candidate 1. If they want to ask for a specific feature, we have a deadline, which is called feature approval freeze. So basically, they need to discuss with us about their features before the feature approval freeze, which is basically 3 months after the release candidate 1. But if you just engage with us and we accepted your feature, even if you are not able to merge, basically to work, I would say, on the change, at least if you just ask for the feature and we said yes, then you are able to provide your feature up to the feature freeze, which is, I would say, in between 1 month and 2 months after the feature approval freeze. Even after feature freeze, we are able to merge other changes, for example, bug reports, bug fixes, I would say, for bug reports. We are still able to merge those specific bug fixes after feature freeze, as you see, for 2 weeks. But then, once we create release candidate 1, then, as I said, for that specific release, it's not possible to merge patches, but given this is RC1, we could be merging other patches for the next release. So basically, we are merging things basically for the whole 6 months cycle. Second concern that I hear that people say, I don't understand your process. Working with Nova is difficult because we don't exactly understand what's a bug report, what's a blueprint, what's a spec. And that's exactly what I will explain in the next slide. First, as a reminder, we don't have processes for the sake of having processes. We have processes because all the maintainers are from different companies and have different priorities. They are trying to review some patches, they are trying to organize the priorities that they have. But that's why we have this kind of process for making sure that all the contributors exactly know when and what to do. Maybe you have heard, but we have 3 different types of code changes in Nova. We have either bug reports, or blueprints, or specification files. To be clear, if you found a regression, if you found an issue that creates a specific exception, then this is pretty clear, this is a bug. This is a bug and you need to create a report. I will explain how in the next slide. If you think that Nova is wrong because it should be doing something else, this is not a bug because Nova works, you're not getting any exception, but you think Nova should be doing something differently, then it's a feature. Depending of the size of the feature, either this is just a blueprint, or this is a blueprint with an additional file that we name a specification file. As I explained, the only difference is that in general, the design of the change needs to be discussed. For example, if you want to modify the API, API, if you want to modify the DB, if there is an upgrade impact where operators need to modify something in order to upgrade, then we need to discuss that, and that's why we have this specification file. Let me explain exactly what this is. I provided an example of the specification file. As you see on that link, for every project, that's not only Nova, but for every project, you can see spec examples, spec templates on the directory. So basically, a specification file, again, is not there just for the sake of having a specific attached file. This is there because you need to explain why, what, and how you need to change something. Why? This is about the use case. Why do you think you want to modify Nova? Because, for example, as an operator, I want to get something from Nova. That's a use case. Then you need to discuss, you need to explain what. What? You basically need to explain we name it the problem description. I prefer to say the feature gap. For example, an example would be every time I'm calling the Nova API, for example, for getting an instance, I'm only getting some values, but I miss that specific value, and that's the value that I would want to get. And then you need to explain with phrases, not with code, with phrases, you need to explain the design. For example, you need to explain which specific DB field you're gonna modify or you're gonna add. You also need to explain the API changes. For example, the new query fields or the new response fields. You also need, as I said, to explain the upgrade impact. For example, if the operator that wants to upgrade has to modify some configuration or has to modify any other things before upgrading. And at the end, you also need to explain how you will be testing it. In general, don't be afraid. You will just explain, for example, that you will be doing some tests, but in some certain circumstances or in certain features, it may be interesting to also modify Tempest. Tempest, I don't know if you know, Tempest is the OpenStack project and tool that basically checks all the service projects API to make sure that we don't regress on the API. So about bug reports. First, this is important. So here I'm talking about bugs. Here I'm talking about exceptions that you got. If you want to fix those, or even if you don't want to fix because you don't have time, but at least you want to report something is wrong, please, please, please file a good report with ideally some reproducer. Tell us, for example, which release you were using. Tell us how you got that exception so that we are able to reproduce. Ideally, also tell us whether you are able to reproduce it on master so that we can understand whether the bug is still present on the master branch. Because sometimes you could think that there is a bug, but maybe the bug can be fixed on later releases. So that's why also it's important to test with master. With the reproducer if you can't. When I say the reproducer, the ways, the steps for you to reproduce the bug. And you also need to, it's nice to set the importance and tags. When I say the importance, whether you think this is a low priority, this is a medium priority, this is a high priority, or this is an urgent priority. When I say urgent, I'm pretty sure that every exception you get, if you create the report, is because it's urgent for you to be fixed. When I'm telling you to set the importance, this is more about what you think, how you think this can be impactful for all the users of Nova. As an example, if you put an instance, but with any glance image, if you boot an instance with any glance image and any volume, and then you're getting an exception, of course this is critical. That means basically Nova doesn't work. If, for example, you boot an instance using a specific flavor where you also use a specific configuration, and basically you know that you need a specific hardware, then it could be low priority because most of the users wouldn't be impacted by that. Tags, I won't explain that. Don't be afraid of tags. Tags is just metadata information we attach on the reports to basically triage them, to exactly know whether it's impacting the scheduler, whether it's impacting other, for example, Lipwirt or other things. If you have time to do bug fixing, which is different from reporting bugs, if you think you have the solution of the bug, then it's important not to wait for reviews. If you just wait for reviews, you won't get reviewed. You won't get reviewed. Because there are so many patches and very few communication that if you just await us to discover your patch, that won't work. This is crucial for you to signal us that you provided a bug fix. What I'm saying here is that in order to do it, at least this is first when you do a commit, on the commit message, this is important that you attach the patch with the bug report that's created. So you need to add close-bug and then the number of the launchpad bug report. That's not the only step that's required. Again, I'm pretty clear because we have many occurrences in the past of good patches that were proposed with no communication that we missed. That's why we recently changed, the Nova community recently changed, and tried to find a way for people to communicate their bug fixes. What we're saying is that it's important to reach the Nova community, either by pinging on IRC, that's the usual mechanism, that's simpler because, for example, if you say something on the channel, someone will look at that and will reply you, and then you could have a discussion. If you're not able to communicate on IRC for either technical reasons or other reasons, you still have a possibility to mention your bug fix by using that specific etherpad. If you don't know what etherpad is an interactive document that people can write. So if you look at that specific document, you will see that basically people can add new lines on that specific document, and for example, they can add the bug fixes that they think are important. Third common misunderstanding. Nova is difficult to understand. Yes, I don't disagree with that specific question. Nova is definitely difficult to understand. That's been 10 years that I'm working with Nova, but I'm still struggling understanding all the concepts because the code is large, because the workflow can be somehow difficult to understand, but that doesn't prevent me to work with Nova and to review patches. That's not a problem. Again, I'm not, even if I'm the PTL, I'm not an expert of all things in Nova. Basically, what you have to understand is that Nova is based on a distributed model between services that talks through RPC in between them. And for persistence, we use different databases. For the sake of that presentation, I can't really go further because it will take me like more than 3 hours to onboard you on the Nova contributions. But I reinforce you the point that if you start to want contributing to Nova, that's probably because you have a situation somewhere and you probably already know where it's broken. Because this is difficult to onboard people working with Nova, there are docs. They are the contributor docs, but there is also the reference docs. I urge you, if you want to work with Nova, to look at both docs, because the process is described, because the architecture is described, because some specific features are described within both of the documentation. That said, and I will be honest, most of the documentation can be stale, can be a bit old. So also, if you look at the documentation and you think something is wrong because it's no longer the case, feel free to raise us that. If you also want to contribute to Nova, this is crucial for you to understand that you also need to provide tests even for a single line change. And we have two different types of tests. We have the general unit tests that you can see here, Nova test units. So in general, that's the tests that people modify when they commit to OpenStack Nova, because that's classic input-output unit tests. But we also have functional tests. Functional tests is a different subset of tests that we run. We run them at the API level, meaning that we simulate a client calling the Nova API. Like for example, in the functional test, I would say, I create an image, I create a flavor, I create an instance based on that image and flavor, and then I want to migrate my instance. That's a functional test. In order to work with the testing framework, we are mocking all the dependencies that we have. For example, with the functional tests, when you write, I create an image, we basically mock the Glance API. You don't need to run Glance in order to run the functional tests, because we simulate the Glance API. That's why we have the fixtures. So if you start looking at the code, you will see that we have both unit tests and functional tests, and those functional tests are relying on those fixtures. The fixtures are here for simulating the dependencies. For example, you don't need to run libvirt. We have a specific libvirt fixture that simulates the libvirt API. And eventually, once you provide a patch, you will get at least one answer. Maybe not a maintainer answer, but at least you will get a Zool answer. Zool is basically the tool we use for testing patches. And as you see, Zool is both running the unit tests, but also the functional tests, but also the Tempest tests. Anyway, the Nova code base is large, and you could be confused. This is a normal behavior, because as well as I say, sometimes I can also be confused with the Nova code base. So again, don't forget to ask for help. That's why I think communicating with us is key to the success. If you're able somehow to communicate with us and say, for example, I don't know how to do it. If you say, I don't know how to do it, this is absolutely understandable. This is understandable because even myself, sometimes I don't know how to do something. But if I don't know how to do it, I'm asking other maintainers and I'm asking other domain experts how they did it. How they will do it, sorry. And eventually, last point, where could I help? Here I'm just giving you a few examples of places where you can contribute without having a specific idea about what. For example, you don't exactly know which specific feature to work with. You haven't found any bug report, which is actually great. But you just have time and you want to help, or you want to start contributing and you don't know where to start. Longing fruits are kind of bug reports that are small enough and self-contained that you can look in order to find a solution. We usually recommend people to look at the longing fruits for that. But we also have a specific subset of features that are already well-defined and we think we can solve as well. So that's also the second. That's also the second thing. What you can also do is even not write code. You can also do code reviews. I understand that not all the people are Python experts. That's not a problem. I'm not a Python expert, but I can just read Python code. But what's most important is not whether you are Python expert. It's rather because if you're a domain expert, for example, GPUs, if you know how GPU works, how GPUs work, you can provide your own insights on some code changes that will modify how the GPU works with Nova. And that's why I think code reviews are important. And last point, which is crucial, if you do a review, you give a vote. A vote is not about being happy or unhappy. This is more about, I think you need to change something, or yes, I think your code is legit. -1 basically means, please modify that before we are able to merge it. That's a very good comment if you do it. Because that means that you found something that all the other people didn't found it. I'm not saying you're smarter. I'm just saying this is crucial. Because when we review some patch, we could miss some context. If you think that even the core maintainers forgot something, don't hesitate to tell. That's why -1s can be very valuable. +1s can also be valuable. If, for example, you're a GPU expert and you said, I tested that, or I think that will work with my specific environment because I have that specific number of GPUs and I know that what you do is correct, that's a very valuable +1. If you just say +1 because you have a colleague that provides the patch, that's not that valuable. Again, the note is not that important. What's more important is the explanation that you provide with the vote. Eventually, that's my last line. What you can also do is to help with docs. For example, the operator docs are within the Nova code base. Yes, as you see, the admin docs are directly from the Nova repository. If you are an operator and you followed the admin guide and you found that something is wrong, that's a Nova patch. That's a Nova patch. So, as you see, even if you're not a Nova expert and you don't exactly know what to modify, if you're an operator, you can still contribute to Nova codebase, just at least by helping others with the documentation. I'm over time, so if you have a very short question, that would be nice. If not, I will be out of the room for other questions.